Good afternoon, everyone. As many of you know, my laboratory has been involved in designing therapies for aniridia. One of the most recent ones was looking at nonsense suppression therapy, and that's specific for patients that have nonsense mutations. However, there are many patients that have other types of PAX6 mutation that atelurin, for example, would not work for. So today I'd like to share with you some other approaches that we've been using to target the defects at the front of the eye in aniridia. And this would potentially work for any type of mutation. One feature of aniridia is glaucoma. And frequently patients have to have multiple different types of drops. Sometimes they have surgical interventions. And in some cases, the glaucoma is resistant to these therapies. And so this results in damage to the optic nerve and loss of vision. So the increased pressure occurs because the ciliary body makes aqueous humor, and this normally exits the eye through two structures called the trabecular meshwork and Schlemm's canal. And so in aniridia, this aqueous outflow is blocked. So the trabecular meshwork and the Schlemm's canal are either blocked by a piece of iris tissue that remains, or they're damaged or they are absent. This results in fluid buildup because it cannot drain. And this leads to an increase in intraocular pressure. So PAX6 is required for the development of these two drainage tissues. And in mice, these structures form after birth from day 4 to day 21 of age. And so our idea then is to develop a treatment option that would repair this damaged outflow pathway after birth. So I'd like to first introduce the concept of downstream targets. So this approach would be suitable for all types of PAX6 mutation. So this idea relies on the fact that, for example, PAX6 being a protein does a number of things. It binds to other genes to drive their expression. So for example, PAX6 binds to the tyrosinase gene, and this results in the induction of the retinal pigment epithelium. PAX6 also directly binds to the TGF-beta2 gene. And after multiple steps, this leads to the development of the lens, ciliary body, trabecular meshwork, and Schlemm's canal. And TGF-beta2 also induces expression of FOXC1. And this is involved in similar structure formation, including the trabecular meshwork. So in the normal mouse eye, PAX6 is expressed in the lens, and this results in the secretion of TGF-beta2. And this TGF-beta2 then goes and helps to develop the ciliary body and the iris. So our approach was to deliver TGF-beta2 to the PAX6 mouse small eye and compare this with topical atelurin treatment. So we decided to go with this sort of downstream target approach because PAX6 itself is difficult to regulate in terms of having too much expression or not enough expression. So the idea is to target downstream targets instead of PAX6 itself. So this is the phenotype of the PAX6 small eye mouse eye. And so even as early as postnatal day 4, you can see in the PAX6 mouse that the iris is stuck to the back of the cornea, unlike the wild type where the cornea produces an angle with the iris. And at postnatal day 21, you can see trabecular meshwork cells in a very small Schlemm's canal, which is not present in the PAX6 small eye mouse eye. And this is best seen on electron microscopy. So here you can see a very high level of modification, the trabecular meshwork, and it basically looks like a sponge. So it has spaces and cells within it, which allows fluid to drain. But in the PAC6 mouse eye, there are very few cells and there are no spaces. So it's underdeveloped and there's nowhere for the fluid to drain. Histologically, if we look at PAC6 expression in the wild type eye, you can see here in green, it's expressed in the non-pigmented epithelial of the ciliary body, whereas in the PAC6 mouse, there's much reduced expression. Similarly, if you look at TGF-beta2 expression, there's high level expression in the lens epithelium, which secretes TGF-beta2, and it's present again in the ciliary body, and also at high levels in the corneal epithelium. Whereas in the mutant animal, there's much reduced level of TGF-beta2. So we hypothesize that if we deliver TGF-beta2 to the mutant eye, we can rescue some of the features of the disease. So how do we deliver TGF-beta2 to the eye? So we need to get the protein into the eye in the time frame of day 4 to day 21 days of age, and we need to get it into the anterior chamber. So there are a number of ways to do this. We could implant a slow-release capsule that contains TGF-beta2, or we could use a viral expression vector to make TGF-beta2 continually, or we could inject cells that secrete TGF-beta2. So we chose this latter approach, and the cells that we chose to do this were mesenchymal stem cells from adipose tissue or fatty tissue. And we chose this because there would be no immune rejection from the mice receiving their own cells. Mesenchymal stem cells have a homing ability to damage tissue. They survive for about 6 weeks and then they die. So once they've done their job, they disappear and they don't cause problems of overexpression of the protein. They're easily manipulable by genetics, and so we can make cells express all sorts of types of protein. And these types of cells have been used in the retina before to deliver retinoschisin to an excellent retinoschisis mouse model. And so they've been used before. So we isolated mesenchymal stem cells from mouse fatty tissue, and we engineered them to express a vector that delivered TGF-beta2. So these are the untransfected cells, and the blue dots represent the nuclei of the cells. And there is a low level of TGF-beta2 expression in these cells, as might be expected. However, when we transfect them with the vector that expresses TGF-beta2, we see a huge increase in the amount of TGF-beta2 present. And when we looked by Western blot, we see, again, a mature form of TGF-beta2, highly expressed. And so we chose a cell line that secreted high levels of TGF-beta2. And in this case, it was one that expressed about 20 nanograms per million cells. So we injected 200,000 TGF-beta expressing mesenchymal stem cells that would be delivering approximately 5 nanograms of TGF-beta2 per day. After the injection, we had a look at the eyes and we could see these small red dots here, which were the cell tracer that marks the mesenchymal stem cells. And when we used an antibody to TGF-beta2, we saw the cells were indeed expressing TGF-beta2, so they hadn't died, they were still there making the protein. So then we looked at the structural benefits of TGF-beta2 expressing mesenchymal stem cells compared to using Aniridia in a start therapy approach. So in the left-hand panel is the wild-type eye with the Schlemm's canal and trabecular meshwork, shown with transmission electron microscopy. And we also looked at the expression of PROX1, which is a marker that labels the endothelial cells of Schlemm's canal. So we can see that the Schlemm's canal is outlined by this dotted line. where there's no therapy given to the PAC6 mouse, there's no trabecular mesh or Schlemm's canal, and it's not present on TEN either, and we see a small level of expression of PROX1. When the small eye mouse was treated with systemic atelier, we didn't see development of the trabecular meshwork or Schlemm's canal, and there was very little expression of PROX1. Using the START therapy, topical drops though, we can see the trabecular meshwork cells, the Schlemm's canal, we also see it on transmission electron microscopy, and we see PROX1 expression in the endothelial cells of the Schlemm's canal. And finally, on the right-hand side are the results from the TGFβ2 expressing mesenchymal stem cells, and again, we see trabecular meshwork and Schlemm's canal and expression of PROX1. So therefore, the TGFβ2 expressing mesenchymal stem cells gives a result that's as good as START therapy approach with topical atelier and drops. So as I mentioned before, we were interested in looking at the downstream targets of PAC6, and TGFβ2 was one of those. But TGFβ2 itself also is involved in directing the expression of two other proteins. One is FOXC1, and the other is PTEX2. So FOXC1, in the FOXC1 knockout mouse, they have a small or absent Schlemm's canal, and they have an underdeveloped trabecular meshwork. And in the PTEX2 knockout mouse, they have a small ciliary body, and they have a small iris stump that blocks the trabecular meshwork. So they have similar features as might be expected from lack of TGFβ2 or lack of PAC6. And both these proteins are required for preserving corneal transparency and regulating growth of blood vessels. So we thought that if we deliver TGFβ2, we should see a change in the expression of both FOXC1 and PTEX2. And that's exactly what we found. So when we did a Western blot of the cornea, TGFβ2 expression in the mutant eye was low, as was FOXC1, but when treated with either atelurin or mesenchymal stem cells, we see a rescue of the protein expression. And we quantified this for both PTEX2 and FOXC1. So in PTEX2, we see about a 40% increase in PTEX2 in the cornea. For FOXC1, we see about a 20% increase in expression. And in TGFβ2, we have almost normal levels of expression in the cornea. So what are the take-home messages from these results? So we know that glaucoma is difficult to treat in aniridia, especially when drops and surgery no longer work. We also know that regulation of PAC6 itself is extremely complex. If you have too much, it's not good, and if you have too little, it's also not good. So we decided that we could try to target the downstream genes instead. We found that short-term expression of TGFβ2 in the PAC6 mouse stimulated both the formation of the trabecular meshwork and Schlemm's canal, and that the known targets of TGFβ2, that is, PTEX2 and FOXC1, are upregulated. We also found that delivery of TGF2 is equally as good as topical atelurin. And so we think this could be a viable approach to treat the anterior segment defects, especially since the trabecular meshwork and Schlemm's canal mature postnatally, both in mice and humans. I'd just like to acknowledge two people in my lab, Jia Wang, who's a postdoctoral fellow, and Bahitha Nizamuddin, who's just finished her PhD on this project. And we were funded by the Sharon Stewart Trust and CIHR Transplantation Program. Thanks very much.